Welcome to Jessum Guy's podcast. I'm Jessum Guy, and this is episode 8. In addition to these pragmatic goals, the powers of financial capitalism had another far-reaching aim, nothing less than to create a world system of financial control in the private hands, able to dominate the political system of each country and the economy of the world as a whole. This system was to be controlled in a feudalist fashion by the central banks of the world, acting in concert by secret agreements arrived at in frequent private meetings and conferences. The apex of the system was to be the Bank for International Settlements in Basel, Switzerland, a private bank owned and controlled by the world's central banks, which were themselves private corporations. Each central bank, in the hands of men like Montague Norman of the Bank of England, Benjamin Strong of the New York Federal Reserve System Bank, Charles Rist of the Bank of France, and Helmar Schacht of the Reichsbank, sought to dominate its government by its ability to control treasury loans, to manipulate foreign exchanges, to influence the level of economic activity in the country, and to influence cooperative politicians by subsequent economic rewards in the business world. Well, thank you for joining me again. This is episode 8. We're going to continue with Carol Quigley's Tragedy and Hope. This is going to cover chapter 6 and chapter 7. Chapter 6 being talking about the Versailles Treaty and what he calls a return to normalcy from 1919 to 1929. It's going to cover the peace settlements. It's going to cover what he says, security, disarmament, but most important is the reparations. Chapter 7 is going to cover the finance, commercial policy, and business activity from 1897 to 1947. Chapter 6 can be pretty easily summarized. I don't think we have to spend a whole lot of time on it, but mainly after World War I, the great powers, they sought to divide up Europe, and they held a lot of these secret negotiations, and they made a lot of these secret treaties that they enforced on all these other smaller nations. These secret meetings and negotiations excluded, Germany, as well as some of these new smaller nations that were created and involved in the war. These political leaders involved were assisted by self-appointed experts of the banking elite. And these experts were involved mainly in the reparations negotiations so that they can get control over foreign exchange market and set up eventually the Bank for International Settlements, or BIS. And this was to be the central bank of central banks. So chapter 6 starts on 267, starts with the peace settlements. You had the Treaty of Versailles, Treaty of Saint-Germain with Austria, Treaty of Neuilly with Bulgaria, Treaty of Trianon with Hungary, and Treaty of Sèvres with Turkey. Not good with these names, sorry. But most importantly would be the two main, but Treaty of Versailles and Treaty of Saint-Germain. Now, mostly concerning us aren't the treaties so much, but who wrote them and what they were set out to accomplish. The idea of these smaller independent nations and the whole make the world safe for democracy shtick, that was the propaganda of World War I, ended up being nonsense when it came down to these peace treaties. And President Wilson at the time was trying to get these nations to accept his 14 points, as well as to get the League of Nations. And the purpose it seems to be what Cooley says is the reason to get the League of Nations was that all the competition between the treaties, all these things that couldn't be agreed upon, could be sort of remedied through the League of Nations. It could just be rammed through. Now, interesting to note that President Wilson's 14 points was written by none other than Walter Lippmann. And he is one who we will find out later is a member of these roundtable groups and was at the time a member of the inquiry founded by Edward Mandel House. And the inquiry was a forerunner to the Council on Foreign Relations. Now, again, the great powers excluded all these smaller nations and were creating all these secret negotiations and meetings to come up with all these treaties by themselves and enforcing them on everybody. And on 271, Quigley tells us, quote, "At all of these meetings, as at the peace conference itself, the political leaders were assisted by groups of experts and interested persons, sometimes self-appointed. Many of these experts were members or associates of the International Banking Fraternity. At the Paris Peace Conference, the experts numbered thousands and were organized into official staffs by most countries, even before the war ended. These experts were of the greatest importance. They were formed into committees at Paris and given problem after problem, especially boundary problems, usually without any indication as to what principles should guide their decisions. The importance of these committees of experts can be seen in the fact that in every case but one where a committee of experts submitted a unanimous report, the Supreme Council accepted its recommendation and incorporated it in the treaty. In cases where the report was not unanimous, the problem was generally resubmitted to the experts for further consideration. The one case where a unanimous report was not accepted was concerning the Polish corridor. The same issue, which had forced the Supreme Council to be cut down to the Council of Four in 1919, and the issue which led to the Second World War 20 years later. In this case, the experts were much harsher on Germany than the final decision of the politicians." And so the Treaty of Versailles, one of the big points was these reparations, forcing Germany to pay an extreme large amount that would be pretty impossible for them to pay. And again, this was largely driven by these experts of the banking elite. Also to remember, a lot of these treaties were taking territory away from the losing teams and sort of redrawing the map, so to speak. And, you know, again, we talked about this previously, that one of the stated goals of the banking elite was the breaking up of empires. And on 275, one of these secret treaties was the Constantinople Agreement, which divided up the Ottoman Empire and promised Constantinople and the Dardanelles to Russia. Now, he says here, the only reason this treaty was known was Russia bailed on the war early, and apparently Britain decided not to go through with this, but the treaty was known due to Trotsky publishing them when the Bolsheviks took power. And also I find it odd that Trotsky and the Bolsheviks supported and encouraged the passing of the Balfour Declaration. It's very interesting. Another thing to note, we also see here British and French concerns over the Middle East regarding oil at this time. One wanted to support the Sultan and the other wanted to support the nationalist groups. And again, it just shows that, you know, we see here that they pragmatically do not care about ideology. And then it's also interesting to note, you know, Standard Oil, Rockefeller's, of course, and BP Shell, these oil cartels were involved in the process this early. And we see on 278, the territorial provisions of the treaties of Saint-Germain and Trianon were such as to destroy completely the Austro-Hungarian Empire. So we move along to page 305, and we finally get to the reparations. He breaks it down into six stages. We have the preliminary payments, the London Schedule, the Dawes Plan, the Young Plan, the Hoover Memoratorium, and the Lausanne Convention. And on 308, the Dawes Plan, drawn up by J.P. Morgan banker Charles G. Dawes. It was an $800 million loan. And after 5 years of Germany paying reparations, they actually owed more than when they began. And what this did, the purpose of this, Dawes Plan, was to set up a foreign exchange system to stabilize the franc and replace the free international exchange system. Eventually, they became the middlemen, and quickly points out that this system was set up by these international bankers, and that the lending of other people's money to Germany was very profitable to them. Now, these were American loans used to help Germany pay reparations. And also with these American loans, Germany was able to rebuild industry and technical facilities. Quote, using these American loans, Germany's industry was largely re-equipped with the most advanced technical facilities, and almost every German municipality was provided with a post office, a swimming pool, sports facilities, or other non-productive equipment. With all these American loans, Germany was able to rebuild her industrial system to make it the second best in the world by a wide margin, to keep up her prosperity and her standard of living in spite of the defeat and reparations, and to pay reparations without either a balanced budget or a favorable balance of trade. By these loans, Germany's creditors were able to pay their war debts to England and to the United States without sending goods or services. Foreign exchange went to Germany as loans, back to Italy, Belgium, France, and Britain as reparations, and finally back to the United States as payments on war debts. The only thing wrong with the system was it would collapse as soon as the United States ceased to lend, and in the meantime, debts were merely being shifted from one account to another, and no one was really getting any nearer to solvency. In the period of 24 to 31, Germany paid 10 billion marks in reparations, but borrowed abroad a total of 18 billion marks. Nothing was settled by all this, but the international bankers sat in heaven under a rain of fees and commissions. Now on 310, the Dawes Plan was replaced by the Young Plan. Now this deal was named after the American Owen D. Young, also a Morgan agent, who served as chairman of the committee which drew up the new agreements. 20 governments signed these agreements in 1930. The agreement with Germany provided for reparations to be paid for 59 years at rates rising from 1.7 in 31 to a peak of 2.4 billion in 1966, and then declining to less than a billion marks in 88. So they were still going to pay reparations all the way up into the 80s, and this is 1930. So the earmarked sources of the funds in Germany were abolished except for 660 million marks a year, which could be commercialized, and all protection of Germany's foreign exchange position was ended by placing the responsibility for transferring reparations from marks to foreign currency back on Germany. So the foreign exchange rules under the Dawes Plan was removed, and that burden was then placed back on Germany. But since they were such nice guys, to assist with this, they created this new private bank called the Bank for International Settlements, which was established in Switzerland at Basel. And finishing the quote on 310, to assist in this task, a new private bank called the Bank for International Settlements was established in Switzerland at Basel, owned by the chief central banks of the world and holding accounts for each of them. The Bank for International Settlements was to serve as a central banker's bank and allow international payments to be made by merely shifting credits from one country's account to another on the books of the bank. Now, Quigley says on 312 that the foreign loans which Germany borrowed could never have been made but for the existence of this reparation system, remember, that was created by the bankers, the experts, since these loans greatly strengthened Germany by rebuilding its industrial plant, the burden of reparations as a whole on Germany's economic system was very slight. So what we had, and keep in mind earlier what we discussed in chapter one, the banker goals was stabilization of currency and to get control of the economy from the governments and, you know, stabilization of the gold standard. And so with the BIS, they went from central banks at major commerce centers like London, Paris, New York, etc., where they controlled the separate bookkeeping in those locations, and they just coordinated. But with the BIS, it became the central bank to unite all of these central banks into one ledger for central bookkeeping, consolidation of the money control. Another thing to consider here, Quigley admits that the wrecking of Germany's economy by forcing them to pay all these massive reparations, which then forced them to borrow all this money, this led to Hitler. And, you know, at the same time they wrecked Germany's economy, they were the ones responsible for building it back up. Again, leading to World War II. And it's something that we should keep this in mind as we get into the chapter on World War II. Now, a couple interesting things about the BIS. You had top-level German industrialists sitting on the board of the BIS. Between 1933 and 45, the BIS board of directors included Walter Funk, a prominent Nazi official, Emil Fuhl, P-U-H-L, responsible for processing dental gold looted from concentration camp victims, as well as Hermann Schmitz, the director of IG Farben, who you should already know about their role with Nazi Germany, and Baron von Schroeder, the owner of J.H. Steinbank, all of whom were later convicted of war crimes or crimes against humanity. So yes, there were Nazis in the bank. Now we also have, as the first president of the Bank for International Settlements, Mr. Gates W. Magara, who had also been chairman of the Rockefeller's Chase National Bank, a member of the General Council of the German Reichsbank, chairman of the New York Federal Reserve, also was the grandfather of CIA Director Richard Helms. He was also a member of the board of directors of the Astor Foundation, which owned Newsweek. And so we have a case study here of Mr. Gates that shows the interconnectedness of all of these institutions and the overall scheme, I guess you could say, plan, and how the associations just as one man can have, just gives you a really good picture of the depth of this. And with that, we will move on into Chapter 7, starting on page 313. Inflation, reflation, deflation, engineering bubbles, and the like. So, Quigley begins the chapter by telling us that efforts were made to build up an international political order different than that one that existed prior. They tried to build this new international order of collective security on the old order of sovereignty and international law. And this was a failure. And he says that economic stresses exposed the weakness of the political structure. He says that the length of the war, which was supposed to end essentially when the gold ran out, exposed the fraudulent reserve system. And then, of course, these bankers, as he says, accordingly, the bankers secretly devised a scheme by which their obligations could be met by fiat money or so-called treasury notes. But of course, these same bankers insisted when the government paid back their debts that they be through taxation and by borrowing at high interest rates. And of course, government leaders were convinced by these financial experts that the best way to pay for the war was bank loans and taxations, which obviously led to inflation and public debt. So, you know, once again, we see them driving up the debt, forcing you to borrow, driving up the debt, not only making you a debt slave, but also your progeny. On page 320, he starts off the section on period of stabilization by saying that as soon as the war was finished, governments began to turn their attention to the problem of restoring the pre-war financial system. And since the essential element of that system was believed to be the gold standard with its stable exchanges, this movement was called stabilization. And because of their eagerness to restore the pre-war financial situation, and he puts in quotes, experts closed their eyes to the tremendous changes which had resulted from the war. Now, he uses the quotes around experts in this section, but not in experts when talking about the bankers, people who helped create all of the treaties and so on and so forth. And I think he means in this, with the quotations, that the, you know, the economists, the government people, the basically the non-bankers, everybody wanted to go back to this pre-war gold standard. And Quigley tells us that this was impossible due to all the economic changes due to the unlimited aims of World War I. And these, quote, experts refused to adapt to the economy of these new conditions. And now Quigley said these changes were already inevitable. And again, all the war did was to speed up the process. He's made this point before. And what is significant in a couple of pages is the understanding that London was losing its role on being the financial capital of the world. And Britain was losing its grip on being the world's preeminent empire. And over the next few pages, from 320 to 323, he lists all the economic factors that led to a complete breakdown of international commerce and the economies. And to note on 322, all nations were experienced this excess in production capacity post-war. Everybody wanted to sell, nobody wanted to buy, and even underdeveloped nations began producing a surplus. And on 323, he says certain countries tried sterilizing the gold, reserves became unbalanced, foreign exchange became unbalanced, trade became unbalanced, prices became unbalanced, new speculators entered the market, which created a big disturbance. People were transferring holdings to find more secure spots. So just global economy as a whole was in complete and utter chaos and was failing. And again, this is due to the war and all of the policies by the banking experts. And then we get to the key paragraph that most people who study this book quote on page 324. And that is, the powers of financial capitalism had a far-reaching aim, nothing less than to create a world system of financial control in private hands, able to dominate the political system of each country and the economy of the world as a whole. This system was to be controlled by a feudalist fashion by the central banks of the world, acting in concert by secret agreements arrived at in frequent private meetings and conferences. The apex of this system was to be the Bank for International Settlements in Basel, Switzerland, a private bank owned and controlled by the world's central banks, which were themselves private corporations. Each central bank sought to dominate its government by its ability to control treasury loans, to manipulate foreign exchanges, to influence the level of economic activity in the country, and to influence cooperative politicians by subsequent economic rewards in the business world. In each country, the power of the central bank rested largely on its control of credit and money supply. In the world as a whole, the power of the central bankers rested very largely on their control of loans and gold flows. In the final days of the system, these central bankers were able to mobilize resources to assist each other through the BIS, where payments between central banks could be made by bookkeeping adjustments between the accounts which the central banks of the world kept there. And I'm pretty sure these bookkeeping, they probably had their own private books versus the open ledgers that others, if anybody could see. Continuing, the BIS as a private institution was owned by the seven chief central banks and was operated by the heads of these, who together formed its governing board. Each of these kept a substantial deposit at the BIS and periodically settled payments among themselves, and thus between the major countries of the world, by bookkeeping in order to avoid shipments of gold. So they just move numbers around on a piece of paper, and today it just digits on a computer. There's no real movement of money, it's just changing ones and zeros. They made agreements on all the major financial problems of the world, as well as on many of the economic and political problems, especially in reference to loans, payments, and the economic future of the chief areas of the globe. The BIS is generally regarded as the apex of the structure of financial capitalism, whose remote origins go back to the creation of the Bank of England in 1694 and the Bank of France in 1803. As a matter of fact, its establishment in 1929 was rather an indication that the centralized world financial system of 1914 was in decline. It was set up rather to remedy the decline of London as the world's financial center by providing a mechanism by which a world with three chief financial centers in London, New York, and Paris could still operate as one. The BIS was a vain effort to cope with the problems arising from the growth of a number of centers. Now, when he says it was a vain effort, he means it failed to fix anything worldwide. But it was very, very successful for the international bankers. It did what they intended it to do, but it was a failure in terms of, you know, fixing actual problems. Continuing on 325, it was intended to be the world cartel of ever-growing national financial powers by assembling the nominal heads of these national financial centers. The commander-in-chief of the world system of bank and control was Montague Norman, governor of the Bank of England, who was built up by the private bankers to a position where he was regarded as an oracle in all matters of government and business. In government, the power of the Bank of England was a considerable restriction on political action as early as 1819, but an effort to break this power by a modification of the bank's charter in 1844 failed. In 1852, Gladstone, then Chancellor of the Exchequer and later Prime Minister, declared, quote, "The hinge of the whole situation was this. The government itself was not to be a substantive power in matters of finance, but was to leave the money power supreme and unquestioned." Unquote. Another quote by Reginald McKenna. I am afraid the ordinary citizen will not like to be told that the banks can and do create money, and they who control the credit of a nation direct the policy of its governments and hold in the hollow of their hands the destiny of the people." End quote. On September 26, 1921, the Financial Times wrote, "Half a dozen men at the top of the big five banks could upset the whole fabric of government finance by refraining from renewing treasury bills." Vincent Vickers, who had been a director of the bank for 9 years, said, quote, "Since 1919, the monetary policy of the government has been the policy of the Bank of England, and the policy of the Bank of England has been the policy of Mr. Montagu Norman." On November 11, 1927, the Wall Street Journal called Mr. Norman, quote, "the currency dictator of Europe," end quote. So there you have it. What was the goal of World War I? Not only to remove long-existing dynastic monarchs, break apart empires, and redraw the map of Europe and Asia to create and control markets, but also to destroy existing economic system so that they can institute their global international economic system and set up the central bank of central banks. They control the world's money and trade, and this war was the catalyst for this process. Now, on 326, he talks about Montagu Norman, Bank of England, and Benjamin Strong of the Federal Reserve, how they worked in concert. And Strong, of course, being a Morgan agent. He says that in the 1920s, they were determined to use the financial power of Britain and the United States to force all the major countries of the world to go on the gold standard and to operate it through central banks free of political control. But neither one of these guys were actually in power, because the real power behind the private banks, as he says on 327, is rather that they were technicians and agents of the dominant investment bankers of their own countries, who had raised them up and were perfectly capable of throwing them down. The substantive financial powers of the world were in the hands of these investment bankers, or so-called international or merchant bankers, who remained largely behind the scenes in their own unincorporated private banks. These formed a system of international cooperation and national dominance, which was more private, more powerful, and more secret than that of their agents in the central banks. This dominance of investment bankers was based on their control over the flows of credit and investment funds in their own countries and throughout the world. They could dominate the financial and industrial systems of their own countries by their influence over the flow of current funds through the bank, bank loans, the discount rates, and the rediscounting of commercial debts. They could dominate governments by their control over current government loans and the play of the international exchanges. Almost all of this power was exercised by the personal influence and prestige of men who had demonstrated their ability in the past to bring off successful financial coups, to keep their word, to remain cool in a crisis, and to share their winning opportunities with their associates. So guys like Montagu Norman, Benjamin Strong, Charles Rist, Hjalmar Schacht, so on and so forth, these guys were not the powers. These guys are what he said were the technicians and the agents of the actual dominant bankers. And who were the guys really running the show? He says on 327, "In this system, the Rothschilds had been preeminent during much of the 19th century, but at the end of that century, they were being replaced by J.P. Morgan, whose central office was in New York, although it always operated as if it were London, where it indeed originated as George Peabody and Company in 1838. While the chief decisions in the firm were increasingly made by Thomas W. Lamont after 1924. And so there you go. The economic system of the entire world is managed, micromanaged by just a handful of guys and a few dozen of their lackeys that run all of these central banks. And so moving along, the next few pages are about a lot of the conferences, and they all came to the conclusion to get back on this gold standard, remove all this interference by the government and the international economy. Quigley admonishes this idea, saying that things already changed too much and that they should have acknowledged this and changed the economy to match the current conditions. And over the next few pages, for any of those who are interested in economic theory, are about the various theories of how to stabilize the world economy without crashing it completely. And so moving along to page 336, you know, all these pages go by governments around the world with bankers. They're trying to stabilize the economy and stabilize the foreign exchange, the prices, production, and so on and so forth. While they're all doing this, these financial capitalists were busy creating bubbles, and they were getting rich when these bubbles would pop, and they would get rich when these corporations were forced to file for bankruptcy. So I made this point before, but the financial capitalists, they don't produce anything, nor did they have a desire to produce. They are only concerned with claims on wealth. They invested not to increase the output of goods or services, but they desired to float issues of securities. And they, you know, once again figured how to create wealth from absolutely nothing, and in fact would get rich when corporations went bankrupt. And so they would actively try to bankrupt companies. And so he says on 336, the period of stabilization merged rapidly into a period of deflation and depression. And quote, as we have said, the stage of financial capitalism did not place emphasis on the exchange of goods or the production of goods as the earlier stages of commercial capitalism and industrial capitalism had done. In fact, financial capitalism had little interest in goods at all, but was concerned entirely with claims on wealth, stocks, bonds, mortgages, insurance, deposits, proxies, interest rates, and such. Investment capital. It invested in capital not because it desired to increase the output of goods or services, but because it desired to float issues, frequently excess issues, of securities on this productive basis. It built railroads in order to sell securities, not in order to transport goods. By the middle stage of financial capitalism, however, the organization of financial capitalism had evolved to a highly sophisticated level of security promotion and speculation, which did not require any productive investment as a basis. Corporations were built upon corporations in the form of holding companies, so that securities were issued in huge quantities, bringing profitable fees and commissions to financial capitalists without any increase in economic production whatsoever. Indeed, these financial capitalists discovered that they could not only make a killing out of the issuing of securities, they could also make killings out of the bankruptcy of such corporations through the fees and commissions of reorganization. A very pleasant cycle of flotation, bankruptcy began to be practiced by these financial capitalists. The more excessive the flotation, the greater the profits, and the more imminent the bankruptcy. The more frequent the bankruptcy, the greater the profits of reorganization, and the sooner the opportunity of another excessive flotation with its accompanying profits. This excess stage reached its highest peak only in the United States. So you see, it is extremely profitable for these people to create and then burst bubbles. And he continues on 337, saying that the growth of financial capitalism made possible a centralization of world economic control and a use of this power for the direct benefit of financiers and the indirect injury of all other economic groups. This concentration of power, however, could be achieved only by using methods which planted the seeds which grew into monopoly capitalism. And so in order to have control, some sort of ownership of stock was necessary. But stock ownership was dangerous to these banks. And he lists reasons then, saying that they figured out how to escape these dilemmas. On the business side, they sought to sever the control of ownership from the securities, meaning to hold control without holding the risk of the securities. And on the industry side, they sought to advance monopolies and restrict production, thus keeping these prices up and their holdings liquid. And capital owned by a large number of people, but yet the control in the hands of few. He says, quote, "To escape from this dilemma, the financial capitalists acted upon two fronts. On the business side, they sought to sever control from ownership of securities, believing they could hold the former and relinquish the latter. On the industrial side, they sought to advance monopoly and restrict production, thus keeping prices up and their securities holdings liquid." Now, on 338, he says that the result of this was that larger and larger aggregates of wealth fell into the control of smaller and smaller groups of men. And while financial capitalism was thus weaving the intricate pattern of modern corporate law and practice on one side, it was establishing monopolies and cartels on the other. Both helped dig the grave of financial capitalism and pass the reins of economic control onto the newer monopoly capitalism. On one side, the financiers freed the controllers of business from the owners of business. But on the other side, this concentration gave rise to monopoly conditions, which freed the controllers from the banks. And so, you know, these changes caused the old investment bankers and financial capitalists to be passed by. But the main goal of control without risk of ownership had been achieved. And so we move along to page 340. And again, he says the BIS was set up so the banks wouldn't have to ship actual gold for payments from one center to the other. They could just be bookkeeping transactions from one central bank. Now, if we think back to, I think it was part one, when he tells us how these bankers used esoteric tricks to conceal money transactions and to create wealth out of nothing. On page 342, he starts talking about the crash of 1929, the Wall Street financial crisis. And again, quickly keeps repeating that people in charge wanted to revert to pre-World War life and economy, and that this was impossible due to the new conditions that was sped up by the war. And this effort, he keeps saying, stalled the inevitable. And all the financial moves that he discussed over the last 20 pages or so were put up. What they did was put up a facade to hide that this truth, and that it took the Wall Street crash and global economic crash to finally get everyone to move on to the next phase of this economic model. And, you know, at first it started in London, and then, you know, they were able to separate gold from the currency, and then eventually everybody got off the gold standard. And so what we had was a run on the banks in Europe in the 30s with Britain ending the gold standard. The American banking system started to collapse. The New York Federal Reserve in America lost $756 million in gold. The banks in the U.S. were closed by executive order. Export of gold was subject to license. Convertibility of notes to gold was ended. And private holding of gold was actually made illegal. And in 1933, America was taken off of the gold standard. Now, he says Britain left the gold standard unwillingly to try to keep orthodox practices. But in America, they did it willingly to create inflation and unorthodox practices, even though their position internationally was still favorable. And then there was a World Economic Conference where the major banking centers, London, Paris, and New York, tried to get an agreement of exchange rates and stabilization and recovery. Because each had disparate gold, they ended without any agreements. But economically, the world was split into three blocks. We had a sterling block out of London, the gold block out of Paris, and the dollar block out of New York. And this led them to trying to shift the burdens to each other. There was like move, counter move. One would, destabilize their currency, which would affect the other one. It was a big mess. A lot you can read. But then he says on 353, what resulted was economic nationalism. This is something you sort of see today with Trump, and something they do not like. But he says, as a result of the crisis, regardless of the nature of its primary impact, all countries began to pursue policies of economic nationalism. This took the form of tariff increases, licensing of imports, import quotas, sumptuary laws restricting imports, laws placing national origin, trademark, health, quarantine restrictions on imports, foreign exchange controls, competitive depreciation of currencies, export subsidies, dumping of exports, and so on. These were first established on an extensive scale in 1931 and spread rapidly as a result of imitation and retaliation. So again, these three blocks were competing with each other. And eventually, all of these moves, American moves, the dollar block out of New York, started to force the countries that were on the gold block to abandon the gold. And on 357, he says that this banker-engendered crisis became a chief cause of World War II. Again, 357, quote, "The historical importance of the banker-engendered deflationary crisis of 1927 to 1940 can hardly be overestimated. It gave a blow to democracy and to the parliamentary system, which the latter triumphs of these in World War II and the post-war world were unable to repair fully. It gave an impetus to aggression by those nations where parliamentary government collapsed and thus became a chief cause of World War II." And we see the fight between banks and bankers or governments and the new unorthodox finance theorists on how to deal with the depression. And what appears to be bankers clinging to the old system while the elites above them are trying to bring in this new system, ending financial capitalism and moving to monopoly capitalism. And then to the next stage, which he says is a pluralist economy. And so we move to 359, where we see the change from financial capitalism to monopoly capitalism had the same effect of commercial capitalism to financial capitalism, and that industry was able to self-finance and free itself from financial control of the banks. But in this stage, control didn't revert from the financiers to the owners, but instead tended to shift into the hands of a new class of bureaucratic managers, whose power of control were out of all relationship to the extent of their ownership of the enterprises concerned. And so if you recall from earlier chapters, banks finance industry in order to control it, but once said industry became so wealthy, they no longer needed financing by the banks, and the banks couldn't control it. And also there was risk involved to these bankers. And so it appears that they learned from this. And in the stage of monopoly capitalism, they learned to gain control over a corporation or industry without any ownership or risk. And so investments weren't for profit, but for bureaucratic control. And helping these corporations and industries gain a monopoly also gives control over these resources. So now not only do they have control over most governments, their money supply, but also most nations' industries and resources. And so again, we see each engineered event leads to further consolidation of control. And so now we move on to the next section on page 360, which is reflation and inflation. And on 362, we see the beginning stages of the military-industrial complex. And one thing that they learned, that building armaments, instead of reducing standard of living for its citizens, actually improved by increasing the purchasing power under this new inflationary policy. The controls put in place to regulate the market during the Depression were never really lifted and were actually extended, further dispelling the notion of this free market capitalism and revealing the controlled planned economy. And because of its position of security, the U.S. was the chief defender of multilateral trade. And on 364, we get to the idea of continental blocks of great powers surrounded by vassal states. And he says, the theory thus led to the conception of continental blocks consisting of aggregates of lesser states about the few great powers. This theory was entirely in accord with the political development of the late 19th and early 20th century. This development had seen an increasing disparity in the powers of states with a decreasing number of great powers. This decline in the number of great powers occurred because of the advance of technology, which had progressed to a point where only a few states could follow. The theory of continental blocks was also in accord with the growth of communications, transportation, weapons, and administrative techniques. These made it almost inevitable that the world would be integrated into increasingly large political units. The inevitability of this development can be seen from the fact that the wars of 1914 to 1945, waged for the preservation of the small states like Poland, Czechoslovakia, Holland, and Belgium, succeeded in reducing the number of great powers from 7 to 2. And so, understanding this theory, why do you think we have been wasting untold trillions of dollars to bring third world nations up to the standard in technology, communication, transportation, health, and etc.? And so, continuing at the bottom of 364 and into 365, the integration of states into blocks by federalism was attainable, but Quigley points to aggressor states that wanted to do it through illegitimate means. And he also makes the point that this could only succeed if it was offered to smaller vassal states as an alternative to the authoritarian solution of the aggressor states. And so, while all these states wanted autarky, the great powers wanted consolidation. And so what he calls liberal states refused both, that is, to offer mutual integration or as a solution to aggression. These liberal states wanted to avoid integration altogether. He says this position put the debtor states like Germany and others into voluntary integration by adopting free trade to pay these debts. So they put the majority of the world into the freer trade position and needing integration to pay their debts, while they themselves adopted policies of isolationism, economic nationalism, protectionism, etc., making federalism impossible. And, you know, Quigley sees this as a failure. But the rise of economic nationalism and bilateral trade strengthened the nation states, which Quigley sees as the problem. Remember, they don't want nation states. Free trade, globalism, international regulatory bodies, these are their ideas, the elite. And the ideas that Quigley sees as the problem are the policies, essentially, that you see Trump strengthening today. Again, economic nationalism, bilateral trade, and then strengthening the nation state, shutting down your borders, so on and so forth. So this is sort of why you see these people, you know, freaking the fuck out about what Trump's doing. He's kind of fucking with the program a little bit. And so the last couple pages deals with the imperative inflation. Not many good nuggets in there. It's good read if you want to understand, have a better concept of the history of economic policies through World War I and World War II. But that's pretty much it for Chapter 7 and wraps up this episode. So in conclusion, you are told who are the big boys, the ones who run everything, and who are their underlings. You get a better idea of their economic policies and that, you know, their machinations behind World War I, things that led to the engineered crisis of the 1929 stock market crash. And again, admits that everything that they did ended up leading to World War II. And everything that they do just continues to consolidate their power and their control and their wealth. And so the next episode gets into Chapter 8, International Socialism and the Soviet Challenge. And so we'll see you next time.